Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Quarrygate Gambit by Marshall Ryan Maresca, narrated by Dan Calley. Prelude. Arrests of Jubilation. Chapter 1. Asti Rynax's plan was going perfectly. Every piece was in place. Every one of his people were exactly where they needed to be, doing exactly what they should. But there were so many details swimming in his head that as he crossed through the back alley to Frost Road, he didn't even see the kid with the knife until it was right at his throat.
"Your coin, old man."
"Old man, really?" Asti asked.
"You heard me," the kid snapped. "Hand it over, or I..."
"I mean, I only just turned 27, Asti said, keeping his voice even. Being called old was quite upsetting. "That's not really old at all, son."
"What you on about?"
the kid said, pressing his knife up on Asti's chin.
"I told you, coin, or I cut you."
"See, you already showed me you don't want to," Asti said. "Else you'd just cut me and search my pockets as I bled."
"I'm serious."
"So am I," Asti said. "I mean, who even taught you? You're not even holding it right."
"What?"
Asti didn't have time for this, but it really was just sad. No form, no technique. "Look," Asti said, taking the kid's wrist and twisting it away from his neck. "You don't want me to be able to do that. And you let me for a couple reasons." The kid cried out and dropped the knife, which Asti caught in his offhand.
"Hey, ow,"
the kid said, as Asti kept his wrist in the lock. "See, right? That hurts a lot," Asti said. "You got too close. And that means you had nothing to thrust with and I could reach past your knife and grab you. Part of the point of having a blade, especially in a situation like this, is you're able to keep the other person at a distance. They don't close in on you because they don't want to get cut."
"The places you want to bet."
"I'm talking about technique, son," Asti said, releasing the kid and pushing him up against the brick wall. He looked at the blade, checking its edge with his thumb. Dull and nicked. "Did you really just grab any knife you could find and come out to an alley? Honestly, who does that?"
"I was just..."
"Look at this, all wrong," Asti said, showing the kid the blade. "Especially if you get in close, put it at someone's neck. You do that, you can only swipe fast to slice my throat, and this blade has no edge for slicing at all. At best, you're going to scratch up someone's neck and just rise up their temper. Then you're in for it."
"What?"
This kid really had no idea what would happen if he rose up Asti's temper. The beast in his skull. It was simple to keep it held by a chain right now. He kept that thing in check every day, through fights or catastrophes where it howled to be let loose. While it wanted to gut this boy open were it allowed, Asti had no trouble holding it down. Certainly he saw no need to hurt this kid, who clearly had no one to teach him anything. Asti threw the knife down the alley and drew out one of his own. "See this one? I've kept honed." He put it in the kid's palm and then wrapped his fingers properly around the hilt. "Feel that. Feel the weight in your hand like that. You've got a good grip."
"I don't..."
"And now?" Asti grabbed the kid's wrist and twisted. "See, you don't let go. You're still in control. Someone's got you like this, you throw a solid punch. You do know how to punch, don't you, kid?"
"What is happening?"
the kid asked, tears coming to his eyes. "Saint Senia, I just want some standards," Asti said. "Is no one teaching you this? Where are you coming from, kid?"
"I..."
"This alley isn't your patch, is it? I know most of the boys your age around here on sight. Blazes, he had some of them scouting for him right now. He shouldn't be wasting time with this. Where are you from?"
"Benson Court."
"Your people didn't teach you any of..." "Saints above, kid." He took a step back, taking a few coins out of his pocket. "I got somewhere to be right now, but you take this. You go back home for the night. Stay out of North Selleth altogether here. You're going to get hurt doing this." Asti put the coins in the kid's hand, only about half a crown's worth in total. Nothing really. The kid just stared at his hand.
"What is happening?"
"Tomorrow, 8 bells in the morning, you meet me at Kimber's around the corner, and I'll show you how to really use that knife."
"I'm keeping this knife."
"Yeah, but don't try anything until I show you. You'll hurt yourself," Asti said. "I need to move, kid. 8 bells. Asti went on his way, the kid still standing dumbfounded as he left the alley and turned onto Frost. The sun was nearly set, the golden red light drawn out over the cobblestone, drenching the street in warmth. For the most part, things had been good in this neighbourhood over the past few months, and tonight, the plans he and his brother Verci had been tolling over were coming to fruition.
"Final target is in sight, Mr. Rynax.
one kid said as he ran up. We got boys keeping eyes on each one of them. Good work, kid, Asti said. Get back out there and make sure everyone is getting steered where they need to, eh? Head boss, the kid said, and he ran off. Asti went into Kimber's pub, a place that wasn't quite a home to him, but served as one enough times that he was comfortable with it. And it was the best place for this plan to go down. And unlike the last time he set up something to shake down here, this one shouldn't end with any broken tables or glasses. At least not too many.
Asti Rynax, there you are.
Asti was surprised to find Kejaz Nafarth, the Poasian spice merchant and double-crossing spy, here in Kimber's pub. This was exactly the sort of place that Nafarth never came into. Asti had barely even seen him out of his spice shop, and this was the absolute last place he needed to have this man right now. Nafarth was an unpleasant sort on a good day when Asti wanted information out of him. Here and now, when Asti had a plan in motion, it was beyond inconvenient. Why are you even here?
I'm hearing things, Asti Rynax, that make me very worried.
As am I, and it's your voice, Asti said.
I think you may be in danger.
I'm pretty much always in danger, but it's nice to know you care, Asti said. Nafarth had taken more of a focused interest in him in the past months, usually while keeping a respectful distance, and never before coming out to find him like this. Asti didn't like it, but he didn't deny that Nafarth was usually worth listening to.
I don't have a lot of time, so how pressing is this? I'm not sure, Nafarth said. I hear whispers. They rarely come with timetables.
Tonight I'm busy, Asti said. If all goes well, then come meet me here tomorrow at 8. Make that 9 bows, and you can tell me all about it. Nafarth thought on this for a moment, and then two other people came down from the room upstairs. He must have thought better of being in close proximity to so many druth folk, and stepped away.
Tomorrow. But be wary, Asti.
Always I am, Asti said. In the taproom, Kimber was shaking her head at Asti.
What did he want?
I neither know nor care, Asti said. The important thing is he's not ruining the plan.
This plan of yours better not wreck my place, she said.
I'll be here in the morning to help you clean, he said. I'm expecting some meetings at 8 and 9 bells respectively, but beyond that, I'm all yours. Her usual warm smile turned a little sad.
You actually believe that, don't you?
Should I?
Doesn't matter, she said. Help me move the tables where you need them.
Of course, he said. He glanced at the door as it opened. Alma Court, the chemist and apothecary, followed by actors and con men, Pilsen Gin and Velen Kolsch came in, dressed and ready for tonight.
Perfect. We better hurry. Verci and Raych will be here soon.
Kimber rolled her eyes.
I can't believe she agreed to this.
Agreed, Asti said. She insisted. Verci had not been prepared for how heavy the crate was going to be. He certainly couldn't carry it alone, and since the contents were so delicate, he wouldn't dare.
Easy, easy,
Raych said as she was lifting her end.
Just a little further end.
Is it in place to slide it?
He asked, sweat already on his brow. He had no idea it would weigh this much, or how Raych didn't seem to be struggling as much as he was.
And there,
she said, letting her side down on the back of the cart.
Go ahead.
He pushed. Saints, how could it weigh this much? And slid it so it rested comfortably in the back of the cart.
You couldn't get a horse to pull it?
Raych asked him as she came around.
There was no way to get one without drawing more attention, he said. People would wonder why we got a horse for this.
People are going to wonder why you're pulling it either way, dear, she said.
He sighed.
So I have to pull.
You most definitely have to pull, my love, she said with a laugh.
She kissed him on his cheek as she threw a tarp over the crate.
That will only make it a little less conspicuous.
You should go on ahead then, Verci said.
Nothing of the sort, she said. I'm walking right by your side, not taking my eyes off this thing. Besides, you will look conspicuous all by yourself. It's just your nature. You always look like you're up to something.
Fair, he said.
He often had been up to something. He still was, frankly, though not as blatantly in recent days.
I've thought about it. If I'm walking with you, I can keep a hand on the crate, make sure it doesn't slide or bump, as that would be...
A disaster, Verci said.
An absolute disaster. Plus...
The cover is making deliveries for the bakery, he conceded. With you right with me, that's a lot more believable. But hopefully no one asks.
Better get moving. Asti is waiting.
Verci took off his vest and handed it to her. Wouldn't do to get it grimy and sweaty before the plan tonight. He was of half a mind to take off his shirt completely.
Don't even, she said, clearly knowing what he was thinking.
I can't be looking like a pig, he said.
It suits me that you're not looking too handsome tonight, she said, raising her eyebrow. Even tonight I wouldn't want anyone else swooning over you.
He grabbed her by her waist and pulled her in, kissing her.
You're the only one I want swooning.
Her eyes danced a bit as they met his.
Oh, if only we had a bit more time right now.
We'll make a bit of time later, he said. Our own celebration.
I like the way you think, Mr. Rynax, she said.
You're damn well better, Mrs. Rynax, he said, and lifted up the handles of the cart and pulled it out into the street.
Raych chuckled quietly to herself as they went, keeping her steadying hand on the crate, as promised. He wasn't sure if that would really help, but it was comforting. Everything about her was comforting, to have her there walking alongside him tonight. He was glad to have her with him here, just the two of them, while her sister watched little Corsi for the night. He was so lost in those thoughts, he barely even noticed when Lieutenant Covrain walked right in front of him.
Evening, Rynaxes, the constable said with the tip of his cap. This seems like a lot.
It certainly is,
Verci said. Quite a sizable crate you're hauling, he said. What's that all about?
Bread's for a few of the inns and pubs along the dog rides, Verci said. At this hour.
You would be astounded at the demand for fresh bread for the suppers, Raych said.
And you load it in a crate like this.
It actually keeps the warmth and moisture in balance, Raych said. I would not have any bread of mine be dry or soggy.
I guess you wouldn't, ma'am, he said. We need to be moving, Verci said as Covrain leaned in as if to smell the bread. He would not get that smell from the crate, and the whole game would be ruined.
I imagine Helen is waiting for you, Lieutenant, Raych said. She's probably quite eager to see you.
And I her, he said with a grin. I should be off and won't keep you.
He went off, and Verci started pulling along again.
Well done.
Thank you.
We would have been skunked if he took a proper whiff of the crate.
I imagine so, she said. But what did your father say about a job getting skunked, as you say?
To drive forward and get it done, Verci said.
Capital advice. Drive on. We need to get there before it's too late. You're late.
Helen Kesser wanted to be annoyed at Jarrett Covrain. She desperately wanted to, as he arrived at her front stoop a good 10 minutes after the agreed-upon time. Jarrett had so many wonderful qualities, but being punctual to any planned rendezvous was never one of them. She wanted to be annoyed, but something about his face tied all that up. She couldn't get mad looking at it. There was...
One more call or such, I know. Julian already went ahead.
Do I have time to change?
He asked, crossing into the apartment. Or do you want me to go in my uniform?
Be quick about it, she said,
though he was already taking off his coat. In the past months, more than a few of his clothes had managed to stay here, which Helen's mother would have found positively scandalous. Helen didn't care about scandalous, though. She just cared about this shop, the apartments over the shop, her cousin Julian, and most improbably, this constabulary lieutenant who was hanging his uniform coat up in her front room. How she had ever fallen so completely for this man was beyond her, and the fact that he apparently felt the same way for her. Her, Helen Kesser, lifelong North Sellis screw-up who was known by half the crime bosses in West Maradaine as being one of the best crossbow slingers south of the river, and also known as too much trouble to ever put on a job. She had run in more heists than she could count and burned more bridges than she could remember. And despite that, this constable, an upstanding statue of a man, had fallen for her, in no small part due to the fact that he respected a good crossbow.
So what is this even about again? He called as he splashed water on his face.
We're having dinner with a new importer Julian is excited about, she said. Brings in Weish and Kieran cheeses, and Julian wants to lock down a deal with him.
Covrain came out, stripped to the waist. Saints, that took her breath every time.
So why doesn't he just do that? He needs us.
You know Julian?
I do, Covrain said. When it comes to your shop, and especially the subject of cheese, he's on top of it.
Contracts and numbers fluster him, she said. He gets really worried that without me there, he would trap us in a bad deal.
Covrain came in close.
So he wants you there, and you want me there.
He kissed her. The sort of kiss that made her want to move to more things. And there was certainly no time for them to do anything like that, at least not before this dinner. She pushed him away before she would have to pull him to the bed.
Get dressed, fool.
Yes, ma'am, he said with a smile that made her blood rush. He quickly grabbed a shirt and coat and put them on, and he looked reasonably presentable. He still looked like a stick, even out of uniform, but nothing would change that.
You've got to leave the belt here, she said.
If I must, he said, taking off his patrol belt with his hand stick and crossbow and left it on her table. Ready?
What do you think? She asked. You haven't said anything about how I look.
She had bothered with face painting for this evening and was wearing a nice dress that had been used for some scouting gig or another. It may have been the one she wore the night they robbed and burned down Tyne's Emporium, designed with extra panels so Verci Rynax could hide the parts of a mini crossbow within it. She was not hiding any weapons tonight. All her crossbows were still in the apartment, safely away in their trunk. She hadn't had cause to use them in months, not since the night with the fire mages.
You look incredible as always, he said, taking her gloved hand.
She almost always wore the glove on that hand now, with a wooden insert to hide her missing finger. Not that the glove was any less conspicuous, but she preferred that was what people saw.
Then let's not leave him waiting, she said. I think we need to get out to the Little East.
Do we need a cab? He asked as they walked out.
Good luck flagging one down on this street, she said. Maybe walk to Keller Cove and catch one there, but...
That was all she got out when some ratty street kid, just dashed through them both, snatched Kovrain's coin bag, and was off down the street. Helen was already running after him, and Kovrain was 3 paces behind.
Thought you said we'd walk, he called after her.
Can't let that guttersnap pull that, she said.
Though when she was that kid's age, she dared exactly this sort of thing plenty of times.
I could put out a call.
No one would come in this patch, she said.
She thought Kovrain would realise, even now, even after that big brawl in St. Bridget's Square a couple months back. Saying she was glad she hadn't been nearby for that one. There were never many sticks in these blocks, and any whistle call would almost always go ignored, especially at this hour. She followed the kid around an alley, down a ways, and saw him slip into the back door of Kimber's pub. She was so intent on that she didn't even notice Kenneth Real running from the other direction until she collided into him.
Whoa,
she said, bouncing off the dark Chimik man. She would have landed flat on her backside if Kovrain hadn't been there to catch her. Kenneth had stumbled back from the impact as well, caught and held stable by Jakal Ra, the native-born Chimik woman he had been courting for some time.
Sorry, Hal, he said, brushing himself off. Didn't see you there.
Likewise, she said, but the fact that he had been running too, running into the same alley from the other direction. That was just plain odd.
Why were you? A Jiqui boy grabbed my bag and dashed here,
Jakal said. She glanced at Kovrain and nodded her head deferentially.
Your pardon, officer.
Not uneasy, he said, but we shouldn't let those boys get away with either of our things.
He went for the door into the pub.
Boys,
Helen muttered. Something did not sit right about this. She looked to Kenneth, who was dressed in a clean suit. But that wasn't uncommon on a night where he was driving the carriage for the North Selleth Inn.
Where were you two headed?
Heading to the Little East to have supper with her cousins, Kenneth said. We were just on our way.
When the urchin grabbed a bag and ran, Helen said.
Saints and sinners both, she couldn't believe it.
You know what this is, don't you?
Aye,
Kenneth stammered. Kovrain and Jakal had already gone in. She sighed and followed, Kenneth right with her. The back door led through a corridor past the water closets to the tap room, which was surprisingly empty. That was an absolute sign that something hinky was up. The tap room at Kimber's pub was never empty.
Where did I? Kovrain asked, glancing about. Something odd indeed, Jakal said. Saints,
Helen muttered. Raising her voice, she said,
Fine, you got us.
At once. Folks leaped out from behind the bar, from the kitchen, from behind tables, from everywhere.
Surprise!
Kovrain, to his credit, jumped just a bit. All around her, familiar faces. Kimber smiling so broadly with such joy. Verci Rynax and his wife Raych wheeling out a giant cake from the kitchens. Julian, grinning like an absolute fool. Alma Court, Pilsen Gin, Velen Kolsch, and a dozen other faces she knew far too well. And more she didn't. Including Chimik folks who were likely kin to Jakal. and Asti Rynax, leaning against the doorway, looking as happy as his face would let him express, which was only a hair of joy above, not angry. "What is this?" Kenneth asked. Verci Rynax, looking far too smug, came up with a tray holding four glasses of wine. "This is a celebration of each of you," he said, handing them all their glasses. "From all of us, your dear friends and neighbours, to raise a glass together to you and for you, and wish hearty congratulations and blessings on your respective futures together, so we can mark the jubilant occasion of your impending marriages. So raise glasses high, one and all, to the engagements of Helen Kesser and Jarrett Covrain, and Kenneth Rill and Jacole Ra of House Geckham, daughter of Hedja Cha, daughter of Kassel Amra." The crowd all raised their glasses and cheered, blazing Verci Rynax, always a flair for the rutting dramatic. Chapter 2. So raise glasses high, one and all, to the engagement of Helen Kesser and Jarrett Covrain, and Kenneth Rill and Jocol Ra of House Geckham, daughter of Heja Cha, daughter of Kassel Amra. The crowd cheered, and Verci was quite pleased with how well the whole ploy had gone. Yes, Helen had figured out what was going on, but it was obvious she had just figured it out only moments before. So the whole affair was, by his definition, a masterful success. He actually would have been a little disappointed in Helen if she hadn't. "Really, what is this?" Covrain asked, still holding his wine glass like he didn't know what to do with it.
"It's a party, Jarrett," Helen growled. "For us, and Ken and Joe." "Do not be so loose with my name," Jacole said. She grinned. "But you, Verci Rynax, I'm impressed with your respect of my mother's."
Verci leaned in. "I did have to make sure to get it right. Well, those cousins of yours over there might have had issue."
"You don't want them to have issue," Kenneth said. He grabbed Verci by the shoulder and pulled him in for an embrace.
"Thank you for this, though."
"There is the matter of my coin purse," Covrain said.
"And my bag."
"Asti," Verci called out.
"Boys," Asti called in return. The two street urchins came out of hiding from behind the bar, sheepish grins on their faces, giving Covrain and Jacole back their things.
"Sorry, mister,"
the one kid said to Covrain. Covrain crouched down and said,
"Let's make that the last time you do that, son, all right?"
Helen shook her head.
"Whose idea was this?"
"This was all Julian's idea," Verci said, pointing to the big guy.
Julian came over, taking Helen's hand and putting it on Covrain's.
"I just wanted to do something special for you two. I didn't know how to do it, but Asti and Verci helped, and then when we heard that Ken and Jacole were getting promised..."
"Yes, who told you all that?"
Jacole pointed to one of her cousins.
"Dekira, were you the one?"
"It was Suki Ankara."
Dekira laughed.
"She wanted to know more about the Asian babe you have spent time with."
Verci chuckled. "She came to the bakery."
"Speaking of,"
Raych said, rolling out the fantastic cake she had made,
"I think I may have outdone myself on this one."
Covrain burst out laughing.
"Of course. Late delivery of bread indeed."
"My apologies for the deception, Lieutenant."
"Most accepted, Mrs. Rynax," Covrain said.
Helen shook her head.
"All this really wasn't necessary."
Despite that, Verci was seeing the grandest smiles he had seen from her and Kenneth for months. The two of them had suffered probably the most at the hands of the Firewings, and anything he could do to make their lives brighter, he would. Verci had let them down that night. They and Alma, who seemed much less troubled by his abuse from the mages, had fought to cover his escape so he could rescue Raych. They had been captured and tortured for his sake, for his family, and he could never repay that debt. But he would keep trying.
"Everything is necessary for you all," he said. He looked at the assembled crowd, the friends who had been at the core of this crew, this family, who had fought to protect North Seleth,
the neighbours whom they had helped, folks he had known all his life, and the new faces like Jacole's relatives and even Covrain's mother and grandmother, quietly talking by the doorway. Verci could even swear he saw an Angelesque limping partway down the stairs and then turning back up. He was amazed the man had survived, but he was amazed any of them had survived this long, given the odds.
"I just want to say one thing," Verci said, taking a beer mug from the bar. "And then if anyone else wants to make a speech, they're welcome. But we do have a few musicians here tonight who've promised to play something lively and danceable, and I imagine you'd all prefer that to my ramblings."
"Yes,"
someone called out.
"Go on,"
Asti said. Verci held up his mug and climbed up on a chair.
Just about everyone in this room. We all have been through some terrible hardship. The fire in Holver Alley, the riots on election night, the fight against the mages, St. Bridget's Square. Kimber muttered a quiet prayer and touched her forehead. And despite that, we're still here, and we have been blessed. Alma's shop recovered from the fire. This pub here, still standing strong. Kess's meat and cheeses, the Junk Avenue Bakery. The Rynax Gadgetarium, Julian shouted. We are here. We are standing tonight to celebrate these two couples because we have been a neighbourhood together. We have stood strong together. We have lost a few friends too, and I hope that their judgments were kind and the saints are letting them watch us now. But we have all been very blessed to be able to be together. Blessings of neighbours, blessings of friends, blessings of family.
Are you crying, Verci?
Raych asked him. He wiped the moisture from his face. I just wanted to express how lucky I feel to be here with you all. I'm grateful that the saints have led an old He remembered Kovrain was here and was still a constable. An old scoundrel like me has such things. And thus, I'm sorry, one last thing. Thus, Helen and Jarrett, Kenneth and Jacob, if you all can love each other even half as much as I love the people in this room, well, your marriages will be deeply blessed indeed. He looked to Helen, whose eyes were watered up.
All right, you fool, get off that chair. There's apparently dancing to be done.
Folks were dancing, people laughing, talking, eating, drinking. Asti was glad to see it all, and Raych had been right. She truly had outdone herself with the cake. It had truly been a success, which was all Asti could ask for. The band had started out playing a few well-worn tavern songs, the sort any West Maradaine folk know by heart, and people sang along and danced. Then when the band took a break, a couple of Jacob's family borrowed the instruments and played their own songs, which had the crowd completely stumped for a moment, until Jacob showed them how to dance to it.
Quite unique festivities,
Kovrain's grandmother said in Asti's earshot.
I've not seen its like.
Oh, I remember you throwing a few raucous dances in your day, Miss Josie, Pilsen Jin told her.
I beg your pardon?
Kovrain's grandmother asked.
You've taken yourself too familiar with me, sir.
Too familiar, that's a laugh. You're still that box girl at heart who'd... Asti jumped up and pulled Pilsen away from the woman before he said something inappropriate.
Apologies, ma'am. He mistakes faces sometimes.
The grandmother said.
I need to find my daughter wherever she's gone off to.
She's sitting over there with Alma, Asti said, pointing to the table. Though from Alma's expression, Asti wondered if he was about to ruin the man's hopes by sending the old woman over. Asti, why are your hands on me? Pilsen said.
Let's get you over to the bar, Asti said, guiding him to a stool.
Kimber, can we get a soft cider here, or even some tea? Kimber nodded and came over.
Pilsen, let me get you something. You just sit right there.
Incredibly kind, madam, incredibly kind. Remind me why I know your face. Did you play Casseria in the production of The Hawk of Erin at the Whirly?
Asti stepped back and found Velen Kolsch's absurdly pretty face far too close to Asti's. He must have dashed across the tap room.
What are you doing to Pilsen?
I was getting him away from Kovrain's grandmother, Asti said, lowering his voice and pulling Velen to one side.
Saints, he thought she was Josie.
Velen sighed.
He's been doing that more and more. How bad has he been? Honestly?
Velen asked.
As long as he has a show, when he's in performance, he's fine. He's tremendous. But the rest of the time, he's... The only people he remembers a lot of the time are people from his youth. He thinks I'm Rendell a lot of the time.
Velen's voice cracked a little on that. Asti only knew Rendell's name from Pop's stories of the old days. Pilsen's paramour 40 years ago. Neither Pilsen nor Pop ever talked about how Rendell died back then.
Sorry, Asti said. It's how it is, Velen said. But it's good to have him around people.
Velen went and sat next to Pilsen. A glass of wine was put in Asti's hand.
I didn't think I needed this, he said to Helen, who had put it there.
Been watching you after night, she said, and if anyone did, I'm sure your future husband doesn't need you watching me.
Puh, Helen said.
He knows full well not to be jealous of you.
Thanks, he said, going to his seat back at the table he had been alone at.
Helen sat with him.
Should you be dancing?
My feet can only take so much, she said.
So you pull all this just for me? and Kenneth and Jacal. And Jarrett? He's a good man, Asti said. Perhaps too good, at least to be in the same room as Asti for too long. But he was a decent man who had saved Raych when it mattered and was good to Helen. Asti tried to have no feud with the man. For you to say that about a stick is a lot. I'm feeling generous tonight. All right, she said, moving her chair closer. So all this I know is still just a front. A thoughtful one, but I know better. What do you think you know? This, she said quietly. All this, the whole reputable citizen act, it's just a part of your whole scheme for stopping the Andrenden thing, whatever that is. Don't tell me you're not still on it, you and Verci, because I know you must be. This has nothing to do with that, Asti said. Honest. But there is a that, Helen pressed. You are working a scheme on Andrenden. And you're going to be a constable's wife soon, Asti said. And that's a far better thing for you than being messed up in our business. Your business is still my business, Helen said. You don't need to fence me out. Helen, it's fine. You don't need to... Asti, she said firmly. I'll remind you that my grandma's killed by this business. You don't need me for what you're working fine. I know you'll call on me when you need a shot taken, but do not fence me out. Let me know you are handling it. Asti nodded. Even with her marrying Covrain, he owed it to her to be straight. It's in long ploy right now. The Andrenden involves money guys from goldsmith houses and some folks in the city council of aldermen. We're still unravelling all the details for now. All right, she said. How? Verci and I are ingratiating ourselves with the college boys and the mechanical firm who are designing and building what will become the Andrenden, which will put us in a position to sabotage it if the opportunity arrives. He sighed. And if we decide it's right to do so. Why wouldn't it be? These folks didn't care how many of us they killed to make this happen. And that I will reckon with, have no doubt, Asti said. But the Andrenden. He wasn't quite sure how to explain it. He barely understood himself. Underground carriages with steam-pulled cables, and people would be able to ride all over the city in a snap. Building the damn thing and then keeping it running, that would be jobs. Jobs in this neighbourhood. The thing itself, it might be a good thing for folks around here in the long run. How could it, given the cost? Like I said, the folks who burned us, they will be reckoned with. But the thing itself, I can't help but wonder if it isn't a real good idea, and if trying to sabotage it is the wrong move. She scowled, but patted his shoulder. I don't see how, but I do trust you here. Thanks. Now I should go save my soon-to-be mother-in-law from Alma. She laughed, getting up. And for the love of saints, give Kimber a dance at least, hm? The night had worn down, and many people had said their goodnights and left, but Raych was enjoying a rare, carefree night in a pub, Corsi at her sister's. It had been far too long since she had done such a thing. Plus, it was delightful watching Verci, who had had just enough beers to join the band and show off his skill in belting out bar ballads. It had become something of a challenge, where he let the band pick any song they could think of, and he'd be able to join in without missing a beat. He was currently crooning one Raych had never even heard of, about the blessed skies over Corifina. She wearily sat down next to Asti. Where did he learn how to do that? She asked. The real story? Asti asked back. She chuckled. You know I always want the real story. When we were kids, Pop made sure we knew every street trick for hustling coin, picking pockets, quick grifts, the whole barn. But he also made sure we knew the cleaner ones as well. So he taught us a whole mess of ballads and lover songs and call-ups and chants from every part of Drithal. And Verci had the better voice for it, as you can hear. Not you. I thought you mastered all sorts of skills. I can carry it, mind you, if I have to, he said. My clean grift was doing charcoal sketches. I could do a sketch of a fellow and his sweetheart in two blinks and sell it for a few ticks. But Verci could suss out where a man was from by his accent and sing the exact song that would make him homesick and easily get a half crown in his hat. So why didn't you all keep doing that? Pop said, and we were just boys, mind you, that we should know how to do honest work if we had to. But it's a much more joyful life to not have to. Your father was a strange man, she said. There are times, Asti said with a weary sigh, that I would have preferred he had been a simple baker who taught us how to make bread. If you really want, you can come to the bakery and still learn. You'd have me there, he asked. And for a moment, there was a hint of a broken little boy in his voice. She rested her hand on his. We're family, Asti Rynax, That's not just something I say, all right? All right.
Who wants to try and stump me? Verci called out. Raych looked up.
Can you do the song of the Trelliana?
Oh, Verci said, an exaggerated look of dismay on his face. I mean, that's not even a Druze song. It's a folk piece from what, the Mayan province of Axaria? He took an instrument from one of the musicians, which if you didn't know is where my wife's family came from, so it would be absurd for me not to know it.
He started to pluck the strings and sing words Raych had known since she was a child, but had never heard from her husband's mouth. I am an honest man who loves the life I live, full of love and joy and blessing, and the songs that I give. Raych's heart leapt, and that took her up on her feet before she even realized she was doing it, and then turned and took Asti's hand, pulling him out to the floor. She had always known the steps. Mother would always dance them, back when her grandparents were around. For a moment, she was a little girl again, dancing with her mother and Leanne, words and steps that were written on her heart. And to her amazement, Asti was right there with her. He knew the dance, knew it like her father had, like he himself had growing up in Damyar. He swept her around the floor, every step perfect, while her husband's voice, his immaculate playing, filled her spirit in ways she had forgotten it could be. By the last chorus, the rest of the musicians had picked up on the tune and the rhythm and were fully with him, filling the taproom with the sounds of her family. The song ended, but her heart still pounded, her face flush as she whirled away from Asti in the final move, almost falling into a table. She laughed as Helen caught her, and she looked back to Asti, who was smiling broadly. She had never seen that on his face before, and Verci was radiant, the same joy on his face that was in her spirit.
Still full of surprises, she told him.
I always will be, Verci said. Then the front door was kicked in, and men in uniform, crossbows raised, swarmed into the bar.
What is this?
Kimber started, and got one of them pointing a crossbow right in her face for it.
Shut it, one of the uniformed men shouted at her. All of you, hands high on your knees.
Asti and Verci followed these instructions faster than anyone, but Kovrain stepped forward. There's just a moment here. That earned him the butt of a crossbow cracked across his nose.
Jarrett!
Helen shouted, leaping to grab him before he collapsed to the ground.
Down on your knees, everyone,
the man who clobbered Kovrain said. Officers, Asti said with infuriating calm. What seems to be the issue here?
Shut it or you'll get it too,
another of the uniforms said. Raych complied, looking to Verci. He mouthed something to her, but she couldn't understand what he was trying to say. But he looked to Asti. Follow Asti's lead. He could handle this. He could tear these fellows up without even breaking a sweat. But yet he was on his knees, hands high, doing what he was told. He was calm. She would be calm as well. Another man came in, his uniform marked with epaulettes.
These are ones, Chief,
the one aiming at Kimber asked.
Yes, indeed, the Chief said. My apologies, people. We are here to apprehend some very dangerous people who are wanted for plots against the Archduchy of Sauria and the Crown.
He pointed to Asti and Verci.
Those two.
What? Verci asked. I'm sorry, but...
A crossbow butt cracked against his face. Raych wanted to scream, but she couldn't even breathe. We'll go quietly, Asti said.
Wise, the Chief said. Also him, and him.
He had pointed out Julian, Alma, Kenneth, Pilsen and Velen.
What?
Helen screeched.
What is going? Julian started.
It's just a damned minute here,
Kovrain said, his nose bleeding. The officer who had hit him raised his weapon to do it again, but this time Kovrain caught it and tore it from the man's hands. The officer drew his sword in response.
I'm a lieutenant in the city constabulary.
Kovrain roared at him.
Lieutenant, this is a matter for the Archduchy. The Chief said, we're taking these men into custody. You do not need to involve yourself.
Name their charges, Kovrain said.
Those are under seal, the Chief said.
We'll go quietly, Asti said firmly. He glared at everyone in the room as if to send a message to each and every person there. We'll give you no quarrel. This is clearly a misunderstanding that will be cleared up. One of the officers took Asti's hands and shackled them behind his back, and did the same to Verci, Julian, Pilsen, Velen, Alma and Kenneth. Jakal and her family all looked like they were ready to tear the Archduchy officers to shreds. Helen, red with rage as Julian's eyes welled with tears. Kimber was weeping in terror. Raych couldn't feel anything, could barely even hear or see. Her body was numb, like this wasn't real. It had to be a trick, some ploy. Was that why Asti was going quietly? Was that what Verci was trying to say to her? The officers pulled the men out of the tap room one by one. Verci was the last one they were taking out, and Raych's legs found their strength. She ran up to him, grabbed his whole body and kissed him like she'd never see him again. The knot in the pit of her stomach told her she wouldn't. One of the officers pulled her off Verci and threw her to the floor. "Hey," Verci snapped, and that officer smacked him across the face. Verci looked up, blood on his lip, and grinned an ever-so-vicious grin. "I'll remember you, friend. I've no doubt." Hands were on her arms and shoulders, Helen and Jacole helping her to her feet. "Verci," she shouted. "I love you," he said calmly as they pulled him to the door. "It's going to be fine." Then he was gone. Raych's heart shattered into 1,000 pieces, and if Helen and Jacole hadn't been holding her up, she would have melted into the floor. Chapter 3. Each of them were loaded into a different lock wagon, and Verci sat in the back of his, arms shackled behind his back, two guards with him, both with swords out. Whatever this was, they weren't playing around. Uniforms were Archduchy sheriffs, or at least excellent replicas. Same with the lock wagon and the shackles. Either these were the real thing, or someone with a lot of resources to spare was behind it. Verci's fingers probed at the shackles. Could he get out of them? Yes, he could, but it would take dislocating his thumb, a trick he was never very good at. He didn't have anything handy to pick the lock, not that he could get to his hand without being noticed, else he'd take that route any day.
"What are you looking at?"
one of his guards asked.
"The man he shoved my wife on the floor," Verci said. "Let me make it clear. That's going to have a reckoning, friend, one way or another."
"Is that what you think?"
"It's what I know."
Verci was of half a mind to dislocate his thumb, pull one hand free from the shackles, and clobber this man with them. Then take his sword, use it to skewer his companion, crack open the doors of the lock wagon, and jump out into the street. He would if he was certain he could pull it off. He was a good enough fighter when he had to be, and could probably manage it. But he had had enough to drink that he knew his reflexes were off, but not enough to be foolhardy. Also, the others were each in their own lock wagon, and he didn't know where they were going. From what he could hear, they weren't even necessarily all taking the same route. They were heading southwest, though. An Archduchy sheriff way station would be outside the city after all. Asti said to go quietly. It would get sorted. Verci trusted in that. Even still, he memorized the man's features and would have that reckoning when the time came. The wagon finally came to a halt. The door popped open, and several men came in to take Verci out. On some level, he was flattered by the lengths they went to here. The building he was being brought into, it definitely looked like a real sheriff way station. If this was a ruse, they were pulling out all the stops. Two men gave him a quick search. For once, he wasn't carrying any gadgets or weapons, but they did miss the screw tool he managed to get out of his pocket and palm, and then put him in a cell. A few minutes later, Asti was thrown in with him. Asti grabbed him in an embrace as soon as the door was shut.
"So, not how I expected our evening to end," Verci said when they pulled away.
"Likewise," Asti said, brushing himself off.
"I presume you decided to comply because it would have been too messy to fight in the middle of Kimber's with several other people there."
"Mostly, but something is off," Asti said.
"You think?" Verci said. "We've not done anything that qualifies as crimes against the Archduchy or Crown. At least, I'm reasonably certain we haven't."
"These fellows seem to be the real deal," Asti said, "and they didn't give any sort of professional courtesy to Covrain."
"You think the problem here is one of courtesy?" Verci asked.
"There are a lot of problems here," Asti said. He moved closer, voice down. "They didn't name charges, which is odd, even when pressed by Covrain."
"I've never heard of charges being under seal," Verci said.
Law officers were supposed to follow the rules on that, telling someone what they were being arrested for.
"What does that mean, they don't have to say what you're arrested for?"
"Archduchy sheriffs have a little more latitude," Asti said. "I've not heard that term before, but Covrain didn't push back on it."
"So it likely is a legitimate term."
"But there's more than not naming charges," Asti said, moving on. "They didn't name us, That chief sheriff, you seen him before?
No.
Me either. But he walked into a room with at least 20 people and quickly picked out you and me, plus Ken, Alma, Velen, Pilsen and Julian. An extremely specific group of people involved in the things we have done together. Who would know that?
But they didn't grab Helen, Verci said. Or Raych, depending on which job we're talking about.
Right, or Jakal. So this has something to do with us as a group, but excludes them, just because they're women.
Can we rule out Josie, some sort of revenge? Verci asked. The last time he had seen Josie Holt, still easily the biggest criminal boss in North Selleth, he and Raych had poisoned her for leverage.
I'm not ruling out anything, but I don't think she has the kind of rattle to arrange something like this.
Who does?
That is the question.
Someone connected to Mendel Tyne, Verci offered.
Asti thought about that. Possible, but Velen wasn't a part of that.
Lord Henterman? Verci offered. We were all in on that.
That opens up several other possibilities, like her, Asti said.
Verci understood. He meant Leora Rand, Asti's former partner in intelligence, whose infiltration of Henterman's home had been ruined by their scheme. Does she have this kind of rattle?
Not that I'm aware of, but she is full of surprises.
So, Verci said, glancing around, I presume they took your nose.
Missed one. You?
Screw tool is all I have, but that hallway hasn't been walked, so I can probably spring the door in a few minutes, and there's 3 doors and 8 guards between us and the outside at least.
And we don't know where the others are.
So you don't want to crack out?
Asti shook his head. There's one or two things happening right now. We've been mistaken for someone else, or we've been targeted. Most likely both, that someone targeted us so we would be mistaken by the sheriffs. That they're the marks in a ploy to get at us.
They put you and me together away from the rest, Verci said. Whoever is doing this wanted to give us a chance to talk.
Maybe listening for a confession, Asti said. Whatever this is, as of right now, we've not been charged or even had our names used. If this is an error, we should ride it through and see what is happening before we make any sort of move. If this is just some terrible mistake and we broke out,
we'd be on the run for good, Verci said.
Last thing you want, Asti said. And if this is some game or ploy on us, well, we need to know more to handle it. But make sure our friends are safe too. Whatever this is, none of them deserve to be dragged along.
Nor did any of the folks who weren't taken.
Asti sighed and nodded. She's going to be all right, and we'll get you back home to her before you know it. Raych didn't know what she could do, so she swept and mopped the floors of Kimber's taproom. It was a concrete action she could manage, a task to focus on. Most of the other guests had left, though Kimber seemed far too stricken to do anything. She stumbled into the back rooms and shut the door behind her. Raych couldn't blame her. Part of her wanted to do that, wanted to fall to the floor and scream, but she needed to do something with her hands. She needed to move, to work. And if Kimber was in no state to clean up, she could do that. Jakal seemed to be in the same mindset. She had made a point of thanking the other guests, getting them out the door, assuring folks that everything would be sorted. Soon it was just Raych, Jakal, Helen and Kovrain. He had been pressing ice and a cloth to his cracked nose and was the only one who was expressing his frustration verbally, though he was coming at it from a very different place.
No procedure, no writs, he said, under seal my foot.
Easy, Helen said as she packed more ice into a rag. Her voice was calm, but Raych could see her fists balled so tight the knuckles were white.
Not to mention they are not supposed to even take any action in the city without some kind of joint structure. Someone from my station house should have at least, as a courtesy, been on the escort.
Jarrett,
Helen said. No, no, he said firmly. Highly irregular. Charges not named and they never named your friends either.
What?
Raych asked. Not that she was able to focus her thoughts on anything but the concrete task of cleaning the floor.
He snapped his fingers, as if in revelation.
The chief. He walked in and just pointed. Him. No names, no charges, no...
I will file a complaint.
How?
Helen asked. With who?
With my captain, for one. I did take note of badge names on most of them. Chief Sheriff Rowles.
Do you think that would help? Helen asked.
There's a path to answers, Kovrain said. He went over to her to kiss her and then winced. I will find out exactly what is happening to your cousin and the rest of your friends.
Believe me, I will not let this slide.
He gave her a gentle peck on her cheek, as if that's all he could manage without hurting his nose again, and left.
Finally, Helen growled. She looked to Jakal. I'm of a mind to do some violence.
Agreed, Jakal said. If I had any idea who to be violent toward.
I'm not feeling particular at the moment.
We can't be stupid,
Raych said quietly.
What?
Helen snapped. Raych found herself drawn fully back into the reality of the moment, pulled in so hard it almost made her stumble. She braced herself with the mop.
We can't be stupid about it, she said.
Are you kidding me?
Helen asked.
Julian, Verci, Asti, Kenneth, all of them, are you going to pretend that they didn't just get arrested?
No, Raych said.
Great prophets, she didn't want to hold herself together here, but it was clear someone had to, and it wasn't going to be Helen or Jakal.
But Asti didn't fight his way through that. Verci took his cue. We need to do the same and not be stupid.
And what does that mean?
Helen asked.
It means we do not know who to be violent toward,
Jakal said.
If I knew who we could charge against for our men, I would be there to fight at your shoulder, but we know nothing. Maybe your man will learn something in his crusade.
Maybe, Helen said.
So what then?
Raych realized she was looking at her.
You want me to decide?
He said not to be stupid.
And I'm afraid stupid is all I got,
Helen said.
Right,
Raych said. What would Verci do here? Or Asti? They would make a plan and then do something stupid when the plan fell apart. Raych had no idea, really, but that thing Kovrain said struck an odd chord.
They weren't named nor given charges, so we need to know more about what's going on before we can do anything else.
All right, how?
Helen asked.
You stay on Jarrett. Use him for as much information as we can get. In the morning, I will raise a sinner's chorus at the Justice Advocate Office.
We might want to look to acquiring our own lawyers as well,
Jakal said.
And you did note that the ones taken were explicitly our fellows who worked the jobs together at the warehouse a few months back.
I did several jobs with those boys,
Helen said.
So why them and not us?
We don't know that we're not the next targets,
Jakal said.
This could be a ploy to isolate us.
Looks like I'm carrying the hip hangers all the time again, Helen said. That solidified things in Raych's mind.
Then we all go together. First to get your weapons from your place, and then we all stay above the gadgetarium tonight.
Verci had rigged their place with so many alarms, special locks and other surprises. No one would get at them easily.
And Kimber?
Helen asked. Raych tried the door to Kimber's room. Latched. No response to their knocks. She was likely completely out.
We'll latch up behind ourselves as we go and, tomorrow, we'll check on her as well.
Raych had no idea what to even say, but she felt she needed to sound comforting, sound in control.
Tomorrow is a very busy day, so let's not waste any more time.
Asti had managed to sleep relatively well in the cell until dawn broke, when a few guards came in with bowls of watery porridge and weak tea. Asti ate it without complaint, as did Verci, and a few minutes later, the guards came again to escort them out.
I take it we have a hearing?
Asti said to one of the guards.
Shut it, the guard said.
I just want to point out, Asti said, ignoring this command. We've not been formally charged with anything, nor have any charges been named, so if anyone is in violation of the law, it would be you fellows.
I ought to,
the guard said, pulling back his arm.
Oh, adding battery to unlawful abduction, very nice, Asti said.
Think you're clever, tackling?
The guard said. Tackling? Asti asked. The guard grabbed Asti's arm and pulled him down the hallway, with Verci being dragged along behind him. Through a few corridors, they were brought into a chamber and placed in two of seven chairs, and then shackled to the chairs.
This seems extreme, even compared to last night, Verci muttered.
Then the others were all brought in. Alma was seated next to Asti as they were all shackled into place.
What is this all about?
Alma asked. He had a fresh cut over his eye.
That's what I got for asking.
Still trying to figure that out, Asti said, though he wasn't sure what he would do if he did figure it out. If he had to pop his thumbs, pull out of the shackles and fight his way out, so be it, but that wasn't how he'd prefer it.
So what did the guard call him?
Tacklin. A man in a tight button suit came in with a pair of sheriffs and looked over the seven of them while thumbing through his documents.
Yes, well done, Sheriff. Well done indeed.
You're going to tell us what this is about? Asti asked.
Humph, the seated man said.
I guess you're going to attempt ignorance? So be it.
Another man came in from the back, this one in magistrate robes. So this was a hearing.
All right, you pulled me out of bed early for this, so let's be about it, he muttered as he took his place at the desk in front of them. And you are?
Ocklin Perrette from the office of the Archduke's Protector, sir, the suited man said, presenting papers to the magistrate.
And your claim here is?
Honourable, presented before you here are the ringleaders of the Corvian Liberation Front, who have organised mayhem, murder and destruction all along the Saurian coast. We are prepared to present no less than 174 charges under seal for these seven men, Marion and Indlen Tacklin, Corrick Vile, Oritan Dale, Gendor and Calic Trentin, and Marken Tar.
Those are quite a lot of charges indeed, Perrette.
Honourable, Asti said. For a moment, he debated how to play this, considering speaking with a more refined accent to address the magistrate. He dropped that idea, as honesty was his best weapon right now. This is clearly a misunderstanding, as we are not those seven men. Those are not our names.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.